Okay, guys, then we'll start the class. I will share my screen.
Mr. Kiran Kumar, are you recording the video?
Yes, sir.
Now you can start the class, no problem.
Okay, sir, thank you. Okay, good evening, guys. Today we will deal with the another important floriculture crop. This is important with respect to the cut flower. This gerbera is botanically called as Gerbera jamesoni and belongs to the family Asteraceae or Compositaceae. And some of the common names are African daisy, transversal daisy, and Barberton daisy. And it will flower throughout the year. And the flower color ranges from white, red, cream, orange, pink, purple. We can observe all the patterns of color in here. Then coming to introduction, Gerbera daisy was first initially discovered in South Africa by the scientist Jamesoni. While this flower scientific name Gerbera jamesoni recollected the name of its founder, one of the great German naturalist, who is Gerbera. Hence, this crop is named in honor of the German naturalist. His name is Gerbera, Traugott Gerbera. Then Gerbera currently ranks in the fifth most popular cut flower in the world trade, behind the rose, carnation, chrysanthemum, and tulip. Then these are the flower color range from yellow to pink, pink to red. Then these are all the wide range of applicability where all the Gerbera flowers are used in day-to-day life. Then in Gerbera jamesoni, this is the commercially cultivated species among the genera Gerbera. Here, there are many cultivars with the bicolor. Here you observe the outer petals are called ray florets and inner petals are called, what do you call them? These outer ray florets, whether what is the sex form of the outer ray florets, then the inner ray florets, then the disc florets. I think you well known with this topic, right? Anyone? The outer ray florets are basically, these are all female in nature. Then inner ray florets are called, they are basically in male sex form. Then the disc florets are in hermaphrodite in nature. Usually in the hybridization process, the disc florets are removed in order to avoid the contamination with the targeted pollen. So we will remove the disc florets and we will cut the ray florets in order to dust the desirable pollen into the female part. You remember this. They may ask in the objective type questions, the sex form of ray florets or the sex form of disc florets in Gerbera or in China Aster. There is a difference between the China Aster and Gerbera sex form. You need to have a keen observation. What is the difference between the sex form in Gerbera and China Aster? Usually in the composite, this formula will be holds good. Then these are all the fully doubled flowers. Then these are all the cacti type of flowering. These are all the thin florets. In the cacti flower also you can observe the florets will be thin in nature. Then semi-double flowers. You observe the inner ray florets are not fully large. They are short in nature. Hence they are called semi-double. These are all the types which are commercially exploited. They may ask in the competitive exams like JRF in, JRF or SRF, which type of the algebra is commercially exploited, double, semi-double, or the bicolored ones, like that they will ask. With respect to cultivars, I will tell you later. These are all the international varieties. Then coming to the cultivation practices of Gerbera, with respect to soil, media, you all well known. The optimum pH is necessary, optimum EC is necessary. Then salinity, we have to look not more than 2 mm. Then with respect to bed preparation, you have to ensure the bed preparation in the Gerbera is also crucial. Then with respect to the bed preparation, the soil, FIM, rice husk, sand. These are all the portions which we are will going to add while preparing of bed. Then with respect to polyo structure, how it should be. The height of the polyo should be 3.5 to 4 meter. This is the ideal height of polyos for the protected cultivation of any floriculture crops. You please remember this, 3.5 or 4 meter. Then with respect to ideal temperature, growing condition of Gerbera, for the flower initiation, 23 degrees Celsius is necessary. And for the leaf unfolding, 25 to 27 degrees Celsius. And the optimum humidity, 80% to 85% should be maintained. Then with respect to propagation of Gerbera, mainly through tissue culture, in commercially, mainly through tissue culture technique. This is the only commercial technique which we are followed in India or any other countries. But with respect to breeding, we'll go for the seed production after the hybridization program. Then this is the traditional way of propagation, like division of clumps. They will collect the clumps at the end of rainy season, then they will divide it, then they will maintain in the growth chamber in order to enhance the rooting percentage. Further, they will propagate it and plant it in the main field. Then they will use for the cutting. Cutting means the bud of leaf axil is also used as a cutting in Gerbera. Then with respect to planting, this is the thumb rule. You remember this. The crown of plant should not be more than 2 centimeter below the soil. It should be only 1 to 2 centimeter above the soil only. If the crown is filled with the soil, the plant will going to die with respect to fungal attack, mainly root rot or Pythium rot. You remember this, 1 to 2 centimeter below the soil. Then we should not disturb the root ball. This is also thumb rule. This will apply for all the crops. Then with respect to fertigation, then important cultural practices in Gerbera, mainly weeding and raking of soil is very important, because weeds will mainly take the nutrients of plants and affect the production of flowers. Hence, weeding is necessary. Hence, they should be removed from the bed. Due to daily irrigation, the surface of the Gerbera bed become hard. Hence, raking of soil is done with the help of a raker. I think you have seen the soil raker, which were used in the protected cultivation. Then this raking will also helps in soil aeration in the root zone. You remember this. These points will arise the questions in the assertion and reasoning type of questions in the JRF or SRF. Then disbudding. Disbudding means removal of inferior quality flowers at the initial stage of plantation. This is termed as disbudding. Removal of inferior buds. That's it. Then this will helps to plant to become strong and healthy. Then removal of old leaves. This is also very important with respect to sanitation. This will helps in keeping the plant disease and pest free. I think you know with respect to the economic threshold level of pest. This is important terminology with respect to entomology. This may also raise the question, what do you mean by economic threshold level? This is the certain level of pest infestation in the field which will not going to affect the economic yield of that particular crop. It will not going to cause the loss of that crop. This is the minimum level of pest infestation. This is termed as economic threshold level. The pest will thrive in the field, but not that much severe. They won't cause that much loss in the field. This is called economic threshold level. Then with respect to plant protection, we're going to use the pesticide, fungicide whenever they are necessary. With respect to harvesting, jabara is a 30 months crop. You remember this. First flower are produced from 7 to 8 weeks after plantation. The average yield will be 200 flowers per square meter. The plant density of jabara is 6 to 7 plant per meter square. This is also important. You remember this. 6 to 7 plants per meter square. Then when we are going to harvest? When 2 or 3 outer aurels of stamen have entirely developed. At that time, we'll go for the harvesting. Then pluck off flowers in the morning or late in the evening or during the day when the temperature is ideal. Then usually the jabara, if you consider the carnation or rose, will harvest the flowers using the secateur. But this is not in case of jabara. You remember this. This is also important question. Jabara are not harvested using the secateurs. Our jabaras are harvested by plucking. Jabaras are harvested through the hand by plucking. The flowers are directly plucked from the plant. It is easy to pluck. We will not use the secateur. You need to remember this. After the harvesting of flowers, we'll going to cut the needle of the stem. Why? In order to dip in the water-soaked pre-cooling solution or preservative. Audible na? You are alert? Anyone can respond? Screen is visible. Voice
yes, sir.
Okay. Can I continue?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Then with respect to yield, ideally the jabara will yield 250 to 300 good quality cut flowers. This is per meter square per year. This is under the protected cultivation. Have you seen jabara growing under open field? Is there any varieties recommended for the open field? Is there any technology to grow outside the polios? Anyone of you came through that technologies, right? Have you heard? No, presently the commercial cultivation of jabara is under the protected cultivation. But in IHR, there has been a recently released open cultivated variety is there. Arka Ashwa. This is the only variety in India suitable for open field cultivation. This is also very important. Remember this one. Then some of the important bullet points I will going to share with you from my short notes. You remember the official description of jabara was given by J.D. Hooker. Then this is the choice crop of polyhouse cultivation. This is highly suitable for potted plant cultivation. You remember this. Which among the following is the choice crop for polyhouse cultivation? They will definitely going to ask this question. They will give some 2 to 3 crops and they will arise the question. This is the choice crop for the polyhouse cultivation. And this is also highly suitable for pot plant cultivation. What we call the potted jabaras, they are called samurais. This is also very important. And they will ask which among the following is a stemless perennial herb, gerbera. You need to remember all these things. Then the type of inflorescence is capitulum. This is also very important. You need to remember capitulum. This is the botanically given name for the inflorescence. This is protogynous. Protogynous means gynoecium. Gynoecium means female part. Female parts will mature first in the gerbera crop. Hence, this will promote the cross-pollination. Then the optimum temperature for gerbera cultivation is 25 to 27 degrees Celsius. The night temperature is 12 degrees Celsius. This is ideal. The main propagative techniques are division of clumps, cutting from the leaf axillary buds, and commercially through tissue culture. You remember this. Then mutation is also important technique of hybridization in gerbera. You remember, mutation is also important technique in breeding of gerbera. Then the gerbera, why it is so popular means it has longer shelf life. This is also important. Then some of the important popular varieties released from TNU are YCD1. YCD means Vernaculum 1. This is the research station located in Tamil Nadu under TNU. Then with respect to IHR variety, Arka Nesra, Arka Ashwa. These are two important. Then earlier I told Arka Ashwa is suitable for open cultivation, but Arka Krishika is suitable for open cultivation. Arka Ashwa is the recent variety, but Arka Krishika is suitable for open type of cultivation. Arka Krishika. Then the main breeders are the leading companies with respect to gerbera breeding is mainly located in Netherlands. We just import the varieties or the hybrids from the Netherlands. Then we will mass multiply in the Indian condition. And we will going to cultivate in the polios. There is no hybrids from the private sector in India. Only we import from the Netherlands. That too from Terra Holland. This is the leading gerbera breeding company. Then severe pest in gerbera is leaf miner. You remember, in every greenhouse cultivation, leaf miner and sucking pests are the major problem. The major disease in the greenhouse condition means foot rot, soil-borne phytophthora. This is the main pathogen in the greenhouse. Then stem break is a disorder in gerbera. You remember this. Stem break means below the capitulum, the flower of the stem is going to break. Why this will happen? If the flower stem is not fully developed, this will going to happen. Then stem break is also a major post-harvest disorder. This is mainly due to lead deficiency. You remember this. Stem break. Then higher pH will leads to chlorosis in gerbera. Then some of the popular names are Barbadian Daisy, Transversal Daisy, American Daisy, Heaton Daisy. These are all popular names. Then gerbera stands fourth position in cut flower after rose. Then the optimum spacing is 30 by 20. Usually gerbera is grown under two row system of planting. You remember this one. Two row system of planting or four row system of planting is followed in gerbera. This is also very important. stem break and premature flower wilt. These are the post harvest physiological disorders in gerbera. Then pulsing solution, the pulsing of flowers with the aluminum nitrate and sucrose will increase the waste life of gerbera. You remember AgNO3 and sucrose will used as the pulsing solution in gerbera. 2 to 3 degrees Celsius is the storage temperature, cold storage temperature of gerbera. These are all stored under 2 to 3 degrees Celsius, less than 4 degrees, for up to 4 to 7 days. What is the basic chromosome number of gerbera? If it is in diploid, gerbera gemsoni is in diploid condition, that is 2n is equal to 2x is equal to 50. Then disc florets are protoandrous, but whole inflorescence is protogynous. If they ask in in-depth questions, this is also important. Usually the gerbera is protogynous, the whole inflorescence is protogynous, the female part will mature first, but the disc florets are protoandry, means male flowers will mature first. Then IHR released varieties are Arka Ashwa, Arka Nesra, Arka Pink, Arka White. You remember four important varieties from IHR: Arka Ashwa, Nesra, Pink, White, and Arka Krushika is for open cultivation. And from the CSRI, Institute of Himalayan Bioresource Technology, they have been also released some of the varieties. These institute varieties are in the series of HIM, Himalayan Bioresource Technology. HIM Abhya, HIM Apurva, HIM Gaurav, HIM Kirti, Soumya, Peace, Glow. These are all recently released CSRI variety. These are also very important. Then we'll see some of the important pest and disease in gerbera. Important pest in gerbera mainly are white flies, leaf miner, mites, aphids, and thrips. These are all problematic in all the greenhouse cultivation. Every floriculture crop, every vegetable crop, anything you grow under the protected cultivation, these sucking pests are very major. Coming to white fly. One sec. Coming to white fly, usually the Bemisia tabaci, this is also important in greenhouse cultivation. Then greenhouse white fly is also important. With respect to symptoms, I think you all well know. I will just brief the life cycle of greenhouse white fly. This may arise some questions in the JRF or SRF. You observe, typically the adult male or female going to lay the egg, and this will convert into larva. First instar larva of white fly are called craveler. You remember this terminology, craveler. Then second instar larva, third instar, fourth instar, then it will go for the pupation. Then it is called as pupidaria. This is also important. This terminology. Any insect will follow the egg, larva, pupa, adult. These are all the four life cycle, different stages of life cycle in any insect. Then coming to management of any sucking pest, we need to monitor the pest population in the greenhouse by observing, then by keeping the track of any sticky traps, like blue sticky traps, yellow sticky traps. But for especially for the white fly, we're going to monitor the pest population using the yellow sticky traps. But the blue sticky trap is used for the aphids. Then these are the natural predators for the sucking pest. You need to remember the predators of white fly and the parasitoids, Encarsia. These are all the very important parasitoids. Then coming to leaf miners, you, for your sake of knowledge, you remember this is belongs to the genera Diptera, family Agromycidae. Here you can observe, this is the adult. It will going to lay the egg in the leaves by puncturing. Then the egg will hatch and the larva will feed the internal content of the leaf. Then it will go for the pupation. You will observe the pupa like this. Then the pupa will going to hatch. Then the adult will come out. This is the life cycle of leaf miner. Adult going to lay the eggs. This will the larva. This is the larva going to mine in the leaves. Go for the pupation. Then adult. This is the typical life cycle of leaf miner. Then coming to mites, Tetranychus. These are the Tetranychus mites. These are also very important in polyphagous condition. These are polyphagous in nature. Polyphagous means it is going to feed on wide range of host. It attacks all the greenhouse plants, both in temperate and tropical condition. Here, the spider mite life cycle, you observe here, egg, larva, protonymph, neutronymph, then adult. This also lacks the egg, larva, pupa, and adult. This is the standard life cycle of any insect. Holometabolous insects. These are all holometabolous insects. But here we'll observe some of the stages are absent. This is also very important. You remember this. Egg stage, larva, protonymph, tetranymph, then adult stage. Then how these mites, these mites are very minute in nature. This will disperse with the crop practices. How they will going to disperse? Through mites or any other sucking pest or any other visitors in the crop. This is the mite damage. The mite damage is, the typical symptom is inward boat shaped manner. The leaves become inverted boat shaped manner. If other sucking pest attacks, the outward boat shaped manners will appear. This is also very important difference you need to remember. Then these are the predators of mite. Predatory mites also there in the nature. Then predatory thrips also there. Then coming to aphids. Aphids also, Mysis, Persicae, Aphis, Gossypii. These are also very important. Here also you need to observe the general life cycle of aphids. In the summer condition, where the abundant of crop will be there, that time it will going to reproduce through asexual reproduction. This will be followed most of the year, mainly during summer cycle. Means asexual means parthenogenic reproduction. And there will be no mating occurs. The male or female will going to directly give the birth to younger ones. This is the female. This larger body is called female aphids. And this flying small body is male aphid. The female will going to give birth to the younger ones. These are first instar aphids, then go for the second instar, third instar, and fourth instar. Then they will come to adult stage. If this is in the summer cycle, here the population buildup is more, but in the winter cycle, only one generation is followed. The male and female, after the fall of sexual reproduction, when the male and female reaches the adult, they will going to copulate. They will go for the mating. Then they will lay the eggs. Then this cycle will follow. In aphids, we will observe two types of reproduction. One is summer cycle and winter cycle. Summer cycle, asexual reproduction is observed. In winter cycle, sexual reproduction is observed. Here you can observe the giving birth of aphids to younger ones, first instar larvas. Here the aphids in the winter cycle, they are going to lay the eggs. Sexual phase and asexual phase. Parthenogenetically reproduced female colony. This is, you need to remember that life cycle. Then coming to thrips. Thrips life cycle is also similar to that of aphids, but here we lack the asexual reproduction. First, after the laying eggs, it will come for the first instar, second instar. Then here, protopupa is observed. Then after that, pupa is observed. Then it will reach the adulthood. For your curiosity, try to understand these concepts. And these are all going to be in your competitive exams further. Here you can observe for the monitoring, they have used the colored sticky traps. For the thrips, mainly used blue traps. Then other sucking pest like aphids, white flies, yellow sticky traps. Then these are all the biological control measures like predatory mites. These are all the parasitoids. Then coming to root knot nematode, Melodovena incognita. In the nematode also, the female will going to lay the eggs. These eggs will be hard in nature. They are called cyst. You remember this word. Cyst are the eggs in the nematodes. These eggs will going to unhatch in the juvenile stage of development. Then after the hatching, they will going to penetrate into the root system. They will go for the development. Then they will reach the adulthood. This is a typical symptom, typical developmental stage of nematode. This is the typical root symptom, galls of nematode. This is Helicorpa armigera. This is also important pest in Gerbera. And for the snails, slugs also important. These are the eggs of slugs. This will complete the today's chapter, Gerbera. Then if any other doubts is there, you can please ask. Any doubts, clarification, or any points for this discussion, you can add. Yes, please, Ankita, Dev, Srishti, Baranya, Sanyal.
No, sir, no doubt.
No, sir, no doubt.
Okay, fine then. If it is that case, I think I tried my best. Then what else we can cover in the next class? We'll cover the dahlia. Which crop can we cover in the next class? Dahlia is okay. Yes, speak out. Srishti.
Okay.
Ankita. Okay, na?
Okay, sir.
Okay. Then we'll discuss the next session on Dahlia. Until then, take care. Bye-bye. Read well. Okay. We'll close the session now. Okay.